This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book, The Red Thumb Mark. Author, Richard Austin Freeman. Preface. In writing the following story, the author has had in view no purpose other than that of affording entertainment to such readers as are interested in problems of crime and their solutions. And the story itself differs in no respect from others of its class, excepting in that an effort has been made to keep within the probabilities of ordinary life, both in the characters and in the incidents. Nevertheless, it may happen that the book may serve a useful purpose in drawing attention to certain popular misapprehensions on the subject of fingerprints and their evidential value. Misapprehensions, the extent of which may be judged when we learn from the newspapers that several continental commercial houses have actually substituted fingerprints for signed initials. The facts and figures contained in Mr. Singleton's evidence, including the very liberal estimate of the population of the globe, are, of course, taken from Mr. Galton's great and important work on fingerprints, to which the reader who is interested in the subject is referred for much curious and valuable information. In conclusion, the author desires to express his thanks to his friend, Mr. Bernard E. Bishop, for the assistance rendered to him in certain photographic experiments, and to those officers of the Central Criminal Court who very kindly furnished him with details of the procedure in criminal trials. Chapter 1, My Learned Brother. Conflagratum and Degree 1677. Fabricatum and Degree 1698. Ricardo Powell, Armiger Thesaurer. The words, set in four panels which formed a frieze beneath the pediment of a fine brick portico, summarize the history of one of the tall houses at the upper end of King's Bench Walk, and as I, somewhat absently, read over the inscription, my attention was divided between admiration of the exquisitely finished carved brickwork and the quiet dignity of the building, and an effort to reconstitute the dead and gone Richard Powell and the stirring times in which he played his part. I was about to turn away when the empty frame of the portico became occupied by a figure, and one so appropriate in its wig and obsolete habiliments to the old-world surroundings that it seemed to complete the picture, and I lingered idly to look at it. The barrister had halted in the doorway to turn over a sheaf of papers that he held in his hand, and as he replaced the red tape which bound them together, he looked up and our eyes met. For a moment we regarded one another with the incurious gaze that casual strangers bestow on one another. Then there was a flash of mutual recognition. The impassive and rather severe face of the lawyer softened into a genial smile, and the figure, detaching itself from its frame, came down the steps with a hand extended in cordial greeting. "My dear Jervis," he exclaimed as we clasped hands warmly, "this is a great and delightful surprise. How often have I thought of my old comrade, and wondered if I should ever see him again, and lo, here he is, thrown up on the sounding beach of the Inner Temple like the proverbial bread cast upon the waters." "Your surprise, Thorndyke, is nothing to mine," I replied, "for your bread has at least returned as bread, whereas I am in the position of a man who, having cast his bread upon the waters, sees it return in the form of a buttered muffin or a bath bun. I left a respectable medical practitioner, and I find him transformed into a bewigged and begowned limb of the law." Thorndyke laughed at the comparison. "Liken not your old friend unto a bath bun," said he. "Say, rather, that you left him a chrysalis and come back to find him a butterfly. But the change is not so great as you think. Hippocrates is only hiding under the gown of Solon, as you will understand when I explain my metamorphosis, and that I will do this very evening if you have no engagement." "I am one of the unemployed at present," I said, "and quite at your service." "Then come round to my chambers at 7, said Thorndyke, "and we will have a chop and a pint of claret together and exchange autobiographies. I am due in court in a few minutes." "Do you reside within that noble old portico?" I asked. "No," replied Thorndyke. "I often wish I did. It would add several inches to one's stature to feel that the mouth of one's burrow was graced with a Latin inscription for admiring strangers to ponder over. No, my chambers are some doors further down, number 6A, and he turned to point out the house as we crossed towards Crown Office Row. At the top of Middle Temple Lane, we parted, Thorndyke taking his way with fluttering gown towards the law courts, while I directed my steps westward towards Adam Street, the chosen haunt of the medical agent. The soft-voiced bell of the temple clock was telling out the hour of 7 in muffled accents, as though it apologized for breaking the studious silence, as I emerged from the archway of Mitre Court and turned into King's Bench Walk. The paved footway was empty save for a single figure, pacing slowly before the doorway of number 6A, in which, though the wig had now given place to a felt hat, and the gown to a jacket, I had no difficulty in recognizing my friend. "Punctual to the moment, as of old," said he, meeting me halfway. "What a blessed virtue is punctuality, even in small things. I have just been taking the air in Fountain Court, and will now introduce you to my chambers. Here is my humble retreat." We passed in through the common entrance, and ascended the stone stairs to the first floor, where we were confronted by a massive door, above which my friend's name was written in white letters. "Rather a forbidding exterior," remarked Thorndyke, as he inserted the latchkey, "but it is homely enough inside." The heavy door swung outwards and disclosed a baize-covered inner door, which Thorndyke pushed open and held for me to pass in. "You will find my chambers an odd mixture," said Thorndyke, "for they combine the attractions of an office, a museum, a laboratory, and a workshop." "And a restaurant," added a small, elderly man, who was decanting a bottle of claret by means of a glass siphon. "You forgot that, sir." "Yes, I forgot that, Polton," said Thorndyke, "but I see you have not." He glanced towards a small table that had been placed near the fire, and set out with the requisites for our meal. "Tell me," said Thorndyke, as we made the initial onslaught on the products of Polton's culinary experiments, "what has been happening to you since you left the hospital 6 years ago?" "My story is soon told," I answered, somewhat bitterly. "It is not an uncommon one. My funds ran out, as you know, rather unexpectedly. When I had paid my examination and registration fees, the coffer was absolutely empty. And though, no doubt, a medical diploma contains, to use Johnson's phrase, the potentiality of wealth beyond the dreams of avarice, there is a vast difference in practice between the potential and the actual. I have, in fact, been earning a subsistence, sometimes as an assistant, sometimes as a locum tenens. Just now I've got no work to do, and so have entered my name on Turcival's list of eligibles." Thorndyke pursed up his lips and frowned. "It's a wicked shame, Jervis," said he presently, "that a man of your abilities and scientific acquirements should be frittering away his time on odd jobs like some half-qualified wastrel." "It is," I agreed. "My merits are grossly undervalued by a stiff-necked and obtuse generation. But what would you have, my learned brother? If poverty steps behind you and claps the occulting bushel over your 30,000 candle-power luminary, your brilliancy is apt to be obscured." "Yes, I suppose that is so," grunted Thorndyke, and he remained for a time in deep thought. "And now," said I, "let us have your promised explanation. I am positively frizzling with curiosity to know what chain of circumstances has converted John Evelyn Thorndyke from a medical practitioner into a luminary of the law." Thorndyke smiled indulgently. "The fact is," said he, "that no such transformation has occurred. John Evelyn Thorndyke is still a medical practitioner." "What, in a wig and gown?" I exclaimed. "Yes, a mere sheep in wolf's clothing," he replied. "I will tell you how it has come about. After you left the hospital 6 years ago, I stayed on, taking up any small appointments that were going, assistant demonstrator or curatorships and such like, hung about the chemical and physical laboratories, the museum and post-mortem room, and meanwhile took my MD and DSC. Then I got called to the bar in the hope of getting a coronership, but soon after this, old Stedman retired unexpectedly. You remember Stedman, the lecturer on medical jurisprudence, and I put in for the vacant post. Rather to my surprise, I was appointed lecturer, whereupon I dismissed the coronership from my mind, took my present chambers and sat down to wait for anything that might come. "And what has come?" I asked. "Why, a very curious assortment of miscellaneous practice," he replied. "At first I only got an occasional analysis in a doubtful poisoning case, but by degrees, my sphere of influence has extended until it now includes all cases in which a special knowledge of medicine or physical science can be brought to bear upon law." "But you plead in court, I observe," said I. "Very seldom," he replied. "More usually I appear in the character of that bête noire of judges and counsel, the scientific witness. But in most instances, I do not appear at all. I merely direct investigations, arrange and analyze the results, and prime the counsel with facts and suggestions for cross-examination. A good deal more interesting than acting as understudy for an absent GP," said I, a little enviously. "But you deserve to succeed, for you were always a deuce of a worker, to say nothing of your capabilities." "Yes, I worked hard," replied Thorndyke, "and I work hard still, but I have my hours of labor and my hours of leisure, unlike you poor devils of general practitioners, who are liable to be dragged away from the dinner table or roused out of your first sleep by, confound it all, who can that be?" For at this moment, as a sort of commentary on his self-congratulation, there came a smart rapping at the outer door. "Must see who it is, I suppose," he continued, "though one expects people to accept the hint of a closed oak." He strode across the room and flung open the door with an air of by no means gracious inquiry. "It's rather late for a business call," said an apologetic voice outside, "but my client was anxious to see you without delay." "Come in, Mr. Lawley," said Thorndyke rather stiffly, and as he held the door open, the two visitors entered. They were both men, one middle-aged, rather foxy in appearance and of a typically legal aspect, and the other, a fine, handsome young fellow of very prepossessing exterior, though at present rather pale and wild-looking, and evidently in a state of profound agitation. "I am afraid," said the latter with a glance at me and the dinner table, "that our visit, for which I am alone responsible, is a most unseasonable one. If we are really inconveniencing you, Dr. Thorndyke, pray tell us, and my business must wait." Thorndyke had cast a keen and curious glance at the young man, and he now replied in a much more genial tone, "I take it that your business is of a kind that will not wait, and as to inconveniencing us, why, my friend and I are both doctors, and as you are aware, no doctor expects to call any part of the 24 hours his own unreservedly." I had risen on the entrance of the two strangers, and now proposed to take a walk on the embankment and return later, but the young man interrupted me. "Pray don't go away on my account," he said. "The facts that I am about to lay before Dr. Thorndyke will be known to all the world by this time tomorrow, so there is no occasion for any show of secrecy." "In that case," said Thorndyke, "let us draw our chairs up to the fire and fall to business forthwith." We had just finished our dinner, and were waiting for the coffee, which I hear my man bringing down at this moment. We accordingly drew up our chairs, and when Polton had set the coffee on the table and retired, the lawyer plunged into the matter without preamble. Chapter 2. The Suspect. "I had better," said he, "give you a general outline of the case as it presents itself to the legal mind, and then my client, Mr. Reuben Hornby, can fill in the details if necessary, and answer any questions that you may wish to put to him. Mr. Reuben occupies a position of trust in the business of his uncle, John Hornby, who is a gold and silver refiner and dealer in precious metals generally. There is a certain amount of outside assay work carried on in the establishment, but the main business consists in the testing and refining of samples of gold sent from certain mines in South Africa. About 5 years ago, Mr. Reuben and his cousin Walter, another nephew of John Hornby, left school, and both were articled to their uncle with the view to their ultimately becoming partners in the house, and they have remained with him ever since, occupying, as I have said, positions of considerable responsibility. And now for a few words as to how business is conducted in Mr. Hornby's establishment. The samples of gold are handed over at the docks to some accredited representative of the firm, generally either Mr. Rubin or Mr. Walter, who has been dispatched to meet the ship and conveyed either to the bank or to the works according to circumstances. Of course, every effort is made to have as little gold as possible on the premises, and the bars are always removed to the bank at the earliest opportunity. But it happens unavoidably that samples of considerable value have often to remain on the premises all night, and so the works are furnished with a large and powerful safe or strong room for their reception. This safe is situated in the private office under the eye of the principal, and as an additional precaution, the caretaker, who acts as night watchman, occupies a room directly over the office and patrols the building periodically through the night. Now, a very strange thing has occurred with regard to this safe. It happens that one of Mr. Hornby's customers in South Africa is interested in a diamond mine, and although transactions in precious stones form no part of the business of the house, he has, from time to time, sent parcels of rough diamonds addressed to Mr. Hornby to be either deposited in the bank or handed on to the diamond brokers. A fortnight ago, Mr. Hornby was advised that a parcel of stones had been dispatched by the Elmina Castle, and it appeared that the parcel was an unusually large one and contained stones of exceptional size and value. Under these circumstances, Mr. Rubin was sent down to the docks at an early hour in the hope the ship might arrive in time for the stones to be lodged in the bank at once. Unfortunately, however, this was not the case, and the diamonds had to be taken to the works and locked up in the safe. "Who placed them in the safe?" asked Thorndyke. "Mr. Hornby himself, to whom Mr. Rubin delivered up the package on his return from the docks." "Yes," said Thorndyke, "and what happened next?" "Well, on the following morning when the safe was opened, the diamonds had disappeared." "Had the place been broken into?" asked Thorndyke. "No. The place was all locked up as usual, and the caretaker, who had made his accustomed rounds, had heard nothing, and the safe was outwardly quite undisturbed. It had evidently been opened with keys and locked again after the stones were removed." "And in whose custody were the keys of the safe?" inquired Thorndyke. "Mr. Hornby usually kept the keys himself, but on occasions when he was absent from the office, he handed them over to one of his nephews, whichever happened to be in charge at the time. But on this occasion, the keys did not go out of his custody from the time when he locked up the safe, after depositing the diamonds in it, to the time when it was opened by him on the following morning." "And was there anything that tended to throw suspicion upon anyone?" asked Thorndyke. "Why, yes," said Mr. Lawley, with an uncomfortable glance at his client, "unfortunately there was. It seemed that the person who abstracted the diamonds must have cut or scratched his thumb or finger in some way, for there were two drops of blood on the bottom of the safe, and one or two bloody smears on a piece of paper, and in addition, a remarkably clear imprint of a thumb." "Also in blood?" asked Thorndyke. "Yes. The thumb had apparently been..."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.